thing that we have on the agenda is the Green Alley selection criteria. And this, I'll just talk about this. No matter where, you know, this thing falls out, I did not do this to embarrass Mr. Tyler, although it seemed to have little spark. Fact matter is, I purposely set this up after the election so it would be an issue. I'm not here to beat up you guys, but I would like your presentation on how you did this, and we will have positive questions.
Okay. Good evening, Michele Virts with the Department of Public Utilities. I'll make this brief. Just a quick background of why we're doing green infrastructure. Richmond is an urban city. We have urban streets that are impaired, and we have several regulations that are coming down to us through the state and federal governments that will mandate that we improve water quality. And so we need to find ways to do that cost effectively in the city. So green infrastructure is one of those tools that we can use. It has multiple benefits. And we're not the only city who's looking at this. There are many cities, including Baltimore, Chicago, Los Angeles, Philly, and New York, who are using these tools to manage water quality and to meet their regulations. And specifically in Richmond, our regulations, one of our upcoming regulations will be to improve the bacteria levels in the James River. And the state has gone through a study to identify ways to improve bacteria levels, and several of those alternatives are green infrastructure, including bioretention, green roofs, rainwater harvesting, principal pavements. So DPU has started looking at pilot projects because this is still pretty new to us, and we want to learn how to effectively construct these projects. So the goals are to reduce the volume, reduce the nutrients, and remove bacteria. Some of these projects that we have done so far are the green alleys that we'll talk about, vegetated rooftops, and this is at our wastewater treatment plants. We've done some schools retrofits and some street retrofits. And each time we're using the state standards so that we can take credit for these and meet compliance. So the green alleys, these are the first pilot project that we started with. We have four projects done now. They essentially reduce the amount of runoff that enters our storm sewer system. The rainwater will go in through the openings of the pavers and infiltrate into the ground. So far we've seen that these can withstand heavy truck traffic, so they can take the garbage truck loads and the delivery truck loads. And they look historic, so they try to mimic our cobblestone as much as possible. And they are pretty low maintenance. We inspect them once a year, and we'll probably sweep them maybe once a year. As I said, we have four that are done, and these four were selected because we were already in those alleys, either with utilities or with drainage improvements, and so the cost to put back a paver system versus a traditional alley system was not significant, and so we wanted to try to bring this technology and monitor it and watch it and see if it was successful. Also, we're doing some street retrofits. In these cases where we have drainage projects identified and it may cost a certain amount to put in traditional storm sewer system, we're looking at alternatives to address that nuisance flooding with a green infrastructure project to also provide benefits to the neighborhood for traffic calming and improving the streetscapes. This is an example of a project that we have on 9th Street, and this was a collaborative effort with the state and through a grant with the National Fish and Wildlife Foundation. This is an example on 14th Street, and this was actually a public-private partnership where DPU partnered with the Capital Trees Organization and the Department of Public Utilities. And in this case, we've increased the urban tree canopy, and we've cost-shared on this green infrastructure project. We've also looked at our school properties and looked at ways we can improve the water quality leaving our schools, reduce the impervious surface at our school properties, and then also provide an educational component. So we've retrofitted two schools. One is Chimborazo Elementary and then one is the Moral Training Center. Other examples of green infrastructure that we're looking into are rain barrels. We offer incentives for those for our stormwater utility customers. Grass swales, filters, which are manufactured BMP, and then rainwater harvesting and cisterns. And we have a few projects that we're starting on, in addition to the ones that I've just presented. One will be in the Bellmead watershed. We've received a grant to install bioretention, some green streets, and some green barrels. In Churchill, we have another green alley that will be put into the model block, the model neighborhoods and building block. And then we're also asking for state funding from DEQ to work with DPW to identify some of the problem alleys and take those alleys and retrofit them into green alleys so we can reduce the regular maintenance that DPW has while providing that water quality benefit. And the last project that we're working on is 10th Street Jefferson Greenway, where this is another public-private partnership that we're working with both the Alliance for the Chesapeake Bay and the Capital Trees Group to essentially retrofit 10th Street from the Capitol down to the canal. So hopefully that wasn't too fast, but if you have any questions?
No, that wasn't too fast.
Great.
I think you did very well. You know, the thing, I got questions here. The monies that we use for this project, where did those funds come from? I'm in total some of the store fees that we're charging our citizens. And you just tell me where the money comes from, first of all.
It depends on the project. Several projects have been grant funding. A few projects have been a private partnership where DPU paid a certain portion and then the private entity costs fundraised for the rest of it. And then a few projects have been specifically funded by just the stormwater utility.
The one at St. Christopher, how was that funded?
That was funded by the stormwater utility. That was an existing drainage project that was four blocks long. And the section that we greened was an alley that had to be paved. And so instead of using traditional pavement, we went with the paver system to take advantage and get some water quality at the same time we get drainage improvements.
Well, do you have any of these projects in queue for Southside? As you know, the annexed area in Southside is sorely hurting for the rain.
Yes.
Stormwater. And I've worked with you all, you have worked with me, you know, on projects that we have.
Yes. We do have the alleys that we've asked for state funding for. Those are alleys that DPW gave us, and there are a few of them in Southside. Where we will take their alleys that have a lot of maintenance issues and drainage issues and we'll retrofit those. I don't have the exact locations, but I know that a few of those are Southside.
We have, I think the real tough part of this whole thing is the fact that we have so many drainage issues in my district and in the annexed area that we don't have alleys, okay? But we have true drainage. I've got places in my district can't buy flood insurance because of the drainage situation. Reed Creek was like, we have that taken care of. You know? There are other pockets that we can't get insurance because the insurance can say, you're uninsurable. You know, we're not selling insurance. And that really is tough on the mortgage and the lenders and stuff like that. And what really, you know, is frustrating to see this stormwater, because when we started out the stormwater feeds 4 years ago, these were the focus for Southside because that's what the problem is. When something like this pops up, you know, it really causes a lot of consternation with the rest of the people. Now, I didn't go out here this evening to generate a whole lot of people and have a whole lot of commotion over this. I really didn't do that. That was not my plan. But I think hearing about this, we do need to know the specifics and how this thing came about. You know, how much more money do we have in this homework that we can start allocating to Southside. I think that would be a perfect question.
Well, we do have several projects planned in Southside, and they are traditional drainage projects. And then at the same time, the majority of our maintenance costs do go to the Southside to address those significant backlogs that have been in place since before this stormwater utility was adopted. So we do spend a lot of time down on the Southside, and we are actively pursuing projects on the Southside.
Do you have an idea of how much money is spent on the Southside as compared to the other districts?
I don't have those numbers.
Can you get that information for us?
It's in the quarterly report. We provide you a report.
Actually, yes, it is in the quarterly report, the CIP quarterly report. We do identify the projects by council district.
Do these projects go, in other words, your society's projects, do civic associations have an opportunity to dial in on what gets done first? I mean, how do we decide what, how we do that?
Right now, we're working through the backlog of projects that have been in place. And at the same time, we're developing a master plan. And the master plan will prioritize projects based on several categories, including health and safety, economic loss, property loss. And so when we have the master plans in place, that will drive our priorities based on the need.
So you're saying that the associations basically do not have much of a say in this?
Actually, no. Every time we do a project, we present it to the association before we get started so that the neighborhood agrees with the project, the neighborhood has a chance to provide any input on the issues of the project. We don't construct any projects before we meet with the neighborhood or the association.
So you don't come in and say, well, these are the different projects we have over your neighborhood, which one should you want to do first? You don't do that. Is that what you're saying?
No, we typically, right now we know the list the neighborhood needs, and we're working through that list. When we have the master plan, it'll be based on the priorities across the city.
There were two greenhouses in the first district. One was like $200,000, the second was like $255,000. And that was, of course, released into the newspaper. Time to snatch it and make some media comments. And it was said in that article that the greenhouse in Christmas cost $40,000. Can you explain that difference?
The St. Christopher's project was actually a drainage project that was encompassed four blocks. So that project was new drainage inlets, it was grading out on the street, it was new storm sewer, and the last piece was the green alley that we decided to include. So the paver portion itself was $40,000, and the entire project was $200,000 to include all of those other pieces.
How much was it, I mean, in that one particular alley? That's not clear to me the way you explained the slump.
How much was it to construct the paver system?
$40,000. And then the other money went to what? Did you tell me that?
It went to storm sewer, it went to new drop inlets, and it went to grading on the street to improve the drainage on the street side.
One thing that strikes me too, you know, there were a couple of green alleys in downtown, and they were prominently talked about in the news releases, and you walk, totally walk. And, you know, we have, you know, why would we have two green alleys that are located in the city behind Monument and Christopher, St. Christopher Road, and not here in the city's website or release from there? For some reason we didn't do that. Because these are questions that I need to ask, and I think they need to be answered. You know? I mean, to me, I'll put it this way. If these were going to my district, I'd be pretty proud of them. And I'd be telling everybody. I'd be around and say, hey, man, you see what I got in my district, you know. But they were not advertised. I would think that would have been part of this. But why didn't they do that?
We are developing educational materials for all of our green infrastructure projects. The reason that we have ribbon cuttings on the 5th Street Alley was because that was the first alley that we constructed, and that was a partnership with the state and the National Fish and Wildlife Foundation through a grant.
that was your flagship mill ours.
That's right.
In the 2011 CIP budget, the green alleys on 12th Street and 5th Street are itemized as green alleys in the budget. So why was that term not used in the 2012 budget in the case of the alley in St. Christopher? We're not specified.
The St. Christopher's project was an overall neighborhood drainage improvement project that included a piece of a green alley. The original intent was not to put in the green alley. The original intent was to improve the drainage for that neighborhood.
So you're saying that that particular project was a bigger project, or just one of the projects, and this green alley happened to be at the last minute say, well, we can do that while we're doing it.
Exactly.
That's what you're saying. Okay, do we have any questions, Mr. Chairman?
Thank you, Ms. Virts.
Okay, thank you very much.
Would you like to clarify one more box on that with utilities?
Sure.
The federal flood insurance program is open to all. Nobody may be denied federal flood insurance. So that if you have constituents that are being denied flood insurance, the federal program absolutely prohibits that. So please advise them to make sure that they're talking to the right people, because they can get flood insurance.
Okay, that's good to know, because they don't know that.
Yeah, any property owner can get flood insurance for standing water. Please make sure they know that.
Okay, very good. Thank you, Mr. Okay, I think that pretty well lines us up. Anything, Mr. Chambers, you'd like to add?
Yes, sir.
This meeting is adjourned.
Thank you.